I'm conscious that people aren't microbiologists, so I've kind of kept it simple, and I'm also in this time trying to encapsulate about 20 years research, so we'll give it a go. This is what we work on. These are the mycobacteria. So what I want to do is compare the kind of mycobacterial pathogens that have environmental routes of infection. So the environment has always been a key thing in what I work with. And we're looking here at my particular strain, which is Mycobacterium avium subspecies paratuberculosis, which is probably one of the worst names for a bacterium in the world. We call it MAP for simplicity. And also compare it with Mycobacteria ulcerans, which is prevalent in tropical countries. Just a little step back, what are mycobacteria? They are bacteria, so they sit in that world. They have a phylum, the actinobacteria. And as you go through, right through to the genus, you can see that they're fairly well described. And again, the one most people have heard about is tuberculosis, which I won't really talk about. They're really quite specialist bacteria. A lot of them are very, very difficult to work with. A lot of people work with standard infections in hospitals. They're far easier to culture and describe. These are aerobic, they're non-motile, they're kind of rod-shaped. We think some of them may be spore-forming, which is quite important when you look at the routes of infection. And also, they have a very, very specialist cell wall, which I won't go into the details of that, but it makes them extremely hard to culture and extremely hard to work with. But it also allows them to be very, very resilient in the environment, so they have a very long survival time. And the virtue of this wall is that you can actually stain it. So with certain stains, you can visualize these bacteria quite easily. So what I'm interested in is the non-tuberculous mycobacteria. These are the ones which aren't involved in TB, and they actually constitute the majority of the mycobacterium. So tuberculosis takes a very front stage view to the public, although a lot of the bacteria aren't nothing to do with it. They are not tuberculosis bacteria, and they're not the bacteria which cause leprosy. They're important environmental opportunist pathogens. A lot of them will get in because we share a habitat and we give them that opportunity to infect the human host. This is how widespread they are. This is tuberculosis at the top. I'm not sure if there's a laser thing on here. Oh, it's one of those. Is a pointer? Oh, right, okay, that's better. I'm sorry, I can only point at one of these, so it doesn't seem to do it anyway. So this is tuberculosis up here. These are the mycobacteria, and you can see they're fairly well spread. And the one I work with, which sits in this complex of bacteria, is well away in relatedness from the tubercular bacteria. And mycobacteria ulcerans sits over here. So the two bacteria that I'm interested in are fairly different in their physiology and what they do. This is Mycobacterium here. What it does, certainly in the Western countries and in the Northern Hemisphere, it causes Yoni's disease in animals, which is a severe wasting disease in animals and has a huge cost to our agricultural industry right across, certainly across Europe, America, and now in Asia. We think this organism also causes Crohn's disease, and this is fairly more controversial. It is causative of Yoni's disease. It's only associated with Crohn's disease, although Yoni's disease and Crohn's disease are very, very similar. And then we have Mycobacterium ulcerans, causes the Bruelli ulcer, which is also has a significant health impact in tropical countries. So these are the two bacteria that we've got. They've got a lot of similarities between them. They're rod-shaped, they're slow-growing. They don't like a huge amount of oxygen. They're obligate pathogens, they'll cause disease, they're an animal pathogen, they're a human pathogen. They have a kind of necrotizing effect within the body. For Crohn's disease, that's within the colon and the intestine, and with Mycobacterium ulcerans, it's in the skin. We think there are certainly routes for environmental transmission for paratuberculosis. and there's a good evidence that there's environmental transmission of ulcers as well. There's no person-to-person transmission, so it's not like TB, where it'll spread through a population. It's going to be contact with the environment, which is a significant factor as well. And the distribution of these bacteria is quite often associated with land use and changes in land use as well. Intensive agriculture certainly brings paratuberculosis into the environment. There are differences. Is each one a zoonotic pathogen? Is it actually transmitted directly from animal to human? There are question marks on both of those. The main environmental distribution for MAP is all animals. All animals can get Yoni's disease. We know that it's in food, which I'll show some evidence for later. Water, aerosols, soil, and sediment. So there's quite a few habitats for it. For ulcerans, it's at the aquatic animals, maybe plants and insects, and wildlife as well. We could also detect these very, very specifically. And these are our specific genetic markers that we can use molecular techniques to find these bacteria. It's particularly useful for paratuberculosis because it's very, very difficult to culture. So we can use molecular techniques to find that. And also, interestingly, they're associated with amoeba. So amoeba in biology, everybody will see an amoeba under a microscope, but amoeba are also extremely common in the environment. They can also host. They feed on bacteria, but they can also actually host bacteria and allow them to survive. So, and the amoeba is also very interesting in that it's an analogy for the macrophage in immunology. So the association with bacteria with an amoeba also tells you something about its way it can fool the immune system. There's differences in disease spread. You can see Crohn's disease is fairly well spread, but in the Northern Hemisphere it's fairly well described. There's more and more information about Africa. Africa's a little bit blank because of the reporting. It doesn't say it's absent. And there are a couple of papers that we've found about Crohn's disease in Ghana itself. So whether it's the same manifestation as we see in the West, we're not sure. And Borrelia also is particularly tropical. So there are differences in the distribution, although in Australia it can be fairly well spread, although some regions of Australia are tropical as well. So there are differences in the distribution of the diseases, and that is purely by climate and habitat. So if I tell you a little bit about MAP, because that's what I'm going to know more about than the other mycobacteria, I'll just describe the organism. Yoni's disease and Crohn's disease, which make up the kind of story of this pathogen. That's what it looks like in a test tube. Most people, when they grow bacteria, they'll just see an opaque suspension of bacteria. You wouldn't be able to see through there. This is a particularly difficult bacterium to grow. It grows in clumps. In each of those clumps is probably about 10 million cells. It makes it extremely difficult to count, extremely difficult to work with. That culture there will take about 6 to 7 weeks to grow. E. coli grows overnight. There's no problem with that. In there, that'll take about six or seven weeks to grow. And it's also specialist media as well. This is one of the things you can do because of that waxy coat I told you about at the beginning. When you stain it with specific stains, the cell walls go red, and you can actually identify them by microscopy, which is really, really good. But unfortunately, paratuberculosis has another trick up its sleeve. This is it growing again in long-term culture. And these are those clumps that we saw earlier. And you can see here within the clumps that there are areas where there's no staining. So what this organism is able to do is change its outer coat. So it'll specifically de-repress and express genes in the coating, and you don't get that waxy staining, which makes it very, very difficult to find, which also makes diagnosis and observation of the organism extremely difficult. So paratuberculosis is a difficult mycobacterium to work with, but it has this ability to change its cloak and make itself invisible. Yoni's disease, this is the animal disease. We know without doubt that infection with MAP under Koch's postulates, etc., MAP causes Yoni's disease. It's contagious, it's chronic, it's often fatal, and it affects primarily the small intestine of ruminants. So in our dairy herds in the UK, the fact that it's a fatal infection is once these animals contract Yone's disease, there's a good chance they will be culled from the herd because they're not productive. And what you get is a wasting away of the cattle. It's a new disease as well of the 19th century. It wasn't described before then. And Crohn's disease itself, I'll tell you, is also a new disease of the 19th and 20th century. These are some of the cattle. You can just see they're slightly wasted. You know, you can see the spine and the ribs. In the UK, they would be classed as underweight, and their production would be severely restricted. We know in the USA, 68% of all the herds in the United States are infected with Yone's disease. That's to say, within the herds, there's at least one or two cattle which are infected. And in the UK, it's 32% of the herds are infected. The difference between the two numbers is a false difference, because DEFRA, which is the United Kingdom Agricultural Agency, actually added two more tests into that statistic and reduced it. We're fairly sure if you remove those two tests, then the British herd is probably about 70% infected. So it's an endemic disease now within British and European cattle. And also, what you also get is these are the sheep, these are the cattle, and I told you about that change in the cell wall. This is in the cattle here. You can see the cells here really well stained, but when you look in the sheep, which is a slightly different strain of paratuberculosis, it then becomes invisible again. It's non-detectable. So that switch in the cell coat is between species and different animals as well. Again, that makes the detection and diagnosis extremely difficult. But we also know that it's not just the cattle who are infected with paratuberculosis, it's domestic wild ruminants and deer, alpaca and horses, a lot of alpaca in the UK at the moment, they're very popular for wool. Pigs, wild boar and dogs, rabbits and their predators, chicken and carrion birds. We can find in birds, you can find Crohn's or Yone's disease type lesions. We know in brown bears, and more importantly in the primates as well. So the primates are infected with MAP, and MAP causes Yone's disease in those animals. We're the only one of the primates where this is not accepted. What this means is this organism is a multi-host pathogen. So it's not just going for cattle, it's right across the animal kingdom. So we have an organism which is difficult to work with and difficult to detect. We have animals which are infected with Yone's disease. Yone's disease is endemic, certainly in the Northern Hemisphere. And that brings us down to Crohn's disease and what's the link with that. This is a systematic disorder. It's a chronic disorder, essentially a leaky gut. You get ulceration and changes in the gut lining, which makes it a miserable and chronic disease, of which many people have to have parts of the colon and ileum removed to get rid of the ulceration. And it can occur at many sites within the intestine. It can also occur from the mouth to the anus, which is very, very different from ulcerative colitis, which is extremely localized in the colon. As you say, Crohn's disease is very well spread across the world. Again, there are areas where there's very, very little reporting, but there are hotspots. Yeah, and Canada and the states, the top of the United States, a hotspot. Scotland in the UK is a hotspot for Crohn's disease. England and Wales are fairly close behind. And you can see, but it is fairly widespread. And we do have emerging information about Africa as well. It's also increasing. This is one of the real worries about Crohn's disease. It's increasing, especially in young children. And you can see here just some samples of different countries where it's been monitored. China is one of them. And they're increasing their use of dairy products in the last 10, 15 years. They also buy in cattle from Europe, which are infected. And also geographically, you can see there's a significant association with the disease worldwide. But the real worry is that increase in Crohn's disease. between Yoni's disease and Crohn's, there's quite a few similarities. There are quite a few immunological differences, which makes the story a little blurred. But again, these are animal and human intestines, and one of the common features between Yoni's disease and Crohn's disease is this cobblestoning you get within the wall, and that this also leads to ulceration. And this is a massive buildup of macrophages within the epithelial cells. And again, we go back to that hiding of this organism. We can see here in the sheep, you see the yellow arrows on there, which show you the mycobacteria actually around the nerve cells within the gut. And in Crohn's disease, we can see exactly the same as in sheep. This organism doesn't stain in humans, so it's adopting that kind of cloak and dagger approach. It's hiding itself. And this is one of the reasons when you come to diagnose and look at tissue, you get a lot of false negatives in human samples. We can detect paratuberculosis in this kind of hidden form using molecular techniques quite easily. And again, what the question we've been asking for quite a few years is: paratuberculosis present in inflamed gut in Crohn's patients? And again, this is just a schematic of how we actually find something which you can't culture. We can take environmental samples, we can take human tissue samples, we can do DNA extractions, we do a very, very specific PCR, which tells us if we get a positive, it really is what we're looking at, and we'll use a real-time PCR to not only identify the organism, but also to quantify it as well. These are some biopsies taken from a lady with irritable bowel syndrome, which actually turned out to be Crohn's disease. So there's a lot of misdiagnosis within the early stages of these diseases. And we snipped out a few little bits of tissue. And when you do that DNA extraction and the PCR, the molecular detection, you can see by the black line that sits along there that we're finding paratuberculosis right through the colon, the terminal ascending and descending colon of this person who's infected and has ulceration. So we can find it in human tissue. In our hands, and that technique, virtually everybody, about 96% of the people we test with Crohn's disease, will show positive for paratuberculosis, which we know causes Yoni's disease. And when people have taken all these negative and positive results that you get across the scientific world, because it's certainly an imperfect world, the statistical analysis of that is that paratuberculosis is closely associated with Crohn's disease, but it's still not accepted as the causal agent. So even with precautionary principle, we should be doing something about paratuberculosis in the environment. And this is a lot of the work we've done, is tracking this organism in the environment. How does it get there? We know that most of our herds are infected with paratuberculosis, and they're going to shed that onto the land as well. So we have a huge agricultural industry, a big animal industry, where there are infections. And the new alpaca farms we have in the UK, they're also starting to become infected. We know zoos are infected as well across the world, and a lot of these animals. Humans are infected as well. We know they shed paratuberculosis in the feces. This is a typical UK sewage plant. And once that water's been treated, it will then pass out into the rivers. And we know that paratuberculosis will pass out because we've sat at the effluent output and collected the water, and we can find paratuberculosis coming through. This water is acceptable to UK standards for release into the environment as treated sewage, but we know paratuberculosis gets all the way through. It's not affected by the process. We know also para is in the retail dairy produce, so it's in milk and in cheese. We weren't very popular when the work was first published in the UK in the mid-90s, that 16% of all semi-skimmed pasteurised milk had live or had, was positive for paratuberculosis. And we could also find live paratuberculosis in there. Across Europe, all the different cheeses which use unpasteurised milk as well as pasteurised are showing signs of live para passing through there. So that's another route of human exposure. The amoebae, which I talked about before, which are an interest to to us in the life cycle of this organism, how it survives, and also there's an interest with mycobacterial ulcerans and how that survives in the environment. And we can see here that's an amoeba on the end, that's a canth amoeba, and when we challenge it with paratuberculosis, we can not only establish paratuberculosis in there, this organism should chew it up and use it as food. It doesn't. Paratuberculosis protects itself and survives within the amoeba. And not only does that, the amoeba will spore form when it's under stress, and we can show here as it goes from its trophozoite form, which is its free form, to its spore form, that you can see those bright dots there are paratuberculosis surviving in cestation. If you then give it some nice conditions, it'll come back out into its normal form. Paratuberculosis is still there and still live. What really worries us, and you don't need to take in the detail of this map, is a whole load of genes within paratuberculosis, which we know or we think are involved in the pathogenicity, and certainly involved in those cell wall changes that we get. When you look at that, those set of genes within the amoeba and within the macrophage, they all upregulate. They switch on to a much higher level than they would be under normal circumstances. So what happens, like with Legionella, once it goes into the amoebal state, it's more pathogenic than it was before it was engulfed. So we've also got an area where this organism might become more pathogenic. It's taken up by the macrophage as well, and therefore it'll upregulate its pathogenicity genes. We've also done the history of paratuberculosis. We've taken very deep cores. These are sediment cores. You can see them just in the bottom of those tubes there. And we can actually find paratuberculosis way down the slices of the tube. And this is sediment which has been deposited at a known rate, so we can actually age the sediment. And we can find paratuberculosis down at around 40 years, which is really when the onset of Yoni's disease really took off, certainly in the UK. So this thing survives as well in the environment, which is a little bit of a worry. It also survives in water. It shouldn't survive in water. It should only survive in an animal system. It requires certain things that the environment can't give it. But what we are able to show in water, and the graph is just, look at the time scale of the graph, that quite a few weeks, such as like the two to three years, it's surviving in water as well. So once it's in the environment, it has a huge survival potential. We were first drawn to Crohn's disease and paratuberculosis because of this map here. This won't mean anything to anybody, but this is the shape of Cardiff in South Wales. And the blue bit down the middle is the river, and the dotty bits are the significant numbers of Crohn's sufferers in that area. They exist outside that area, but there are significant areas which were associated with the river where the Crohn's sufferer numbers were higher. We went into the river, and we've gone into a number of rivers, and the little black dots on the graph is the presence of paratuberculosis in the river. So we sat there for a year, took two samples a week, and analysed it for paratuberculosis. And what we found was that paratuberculosis was flowing down the river at regular intervals, in pulses. There were some gaps of a number of weeks, then it would be coming down for a number of weeks. This is paratuberculosis being driven into the rivers by rainfall on the high catchments, which is coming out of the cows, which are infected on those high catchments in the high hill areas. So what we are able to show, that MAP is present in the River Taff consistently, in 32% of the samples of a year, distributed right the way through the catchment, so we go all the way out there and take soil samples, and historically it was there for over 40 years, which fits the story of the emergence of Crohn's disease. And when you actually look at the shape, and this is a topological map of the area, and you can actually push this map into that area, and what it shows is that we can actually describe, one, why we've got significant numbers there, but why there's nothing there. Because at this point here, this fits into the shadow of a hillside, and what we get in Britain is a prevailing wind, which is predominantly southwesterly, so it's coming over that hill, and we're getting a wind shadow here. So if the river's something to do with the Crohn's disease, then we think that mycobacteria, because of that waxy coat, like to be in aerosols. And so we think that aerosols were the main driver of the clusters of Crohn's patients within that area. and that's the hypothesis we put forward. We then went and sat on the banks of the river. We spend a lot of time sitting on the banks of rivers. We don't go fishing or anything. We just kind of talk and read newspapers. But we put aerosol collectors down the side of the river, and we were able to show that paratuberculosis was coming out of the river on aerosols. So that kind of fits our idea that the aerosols had a significant role in the clustering of the Crohn's patients. We also went to another river, which was several, about 30 miles away from the River Taff. This is the River Towy. And what we were able to show here, that in this river, which is far more encapsulated by agricultural catchments, that 70% of all our water samples were positive. And it was significantly associated with the rainfall. So when it rained heavily over a period, we knew we would get paratuberculosis being washed off into the river. So that was absolutely predictable. So we came up with this model, which we work on, where the rivers are the main pit. This is a model of human exposure. We know that humans are exposed through breast milk from Crohn's disease mothers. We know, as I'll show you, it comes through drinking water. We know it comes from the catchment, which is the far end from the infected animals. It flows through the rivers. We know the aerosols are there, and we know it's back cycled into the rivers from sewage. Also, we do a lot of water purification, and the byproduct of water purification in the UK is soil, because you're going to lift out all the soil from the river before it meets the consumer. That soil is put back on the catchment because it's good rich soil. That is absolutely brimming with paratuberculosis. So we're actually reinfecting other areas of the environment. So we have a model for exposure, and the dairy industry is also a major part of that. We also took the opportunity to go right across the United Kingdom, take soil samples all the way through, and analyse them for paratuberculosis. And we were able to find, and I don't expect you to go into these graphs, but what we actually showed is you go from the north to the south of the UK, that paratuberculosis, the presence of it, significantly increases, and that is associated with the numbers of cattle, which also increase from north to south. It also is associated with an acid to alkali change in the soil, which you also expect with grasslands as well, and that's where all the cattle do their grazing. So we've actually shown that it's now out right across the UK in soil, but it's also, we're able to show that it's outside areas significantly associated with farming. So it's now in woodland and it's in other areas, and this is the capture of para by other animals and them spreading it outside the agricultural area. More worryingly, some of our recent stuff is that we found the aerosols on the river, which were fitting this story, but also we're finding paratuberculosis in domestic showers. And one of the problems with young children when they get Crohn's is that, and anyway else, it can start with a respiratory disease. And again, we think that paratuberculosis will come out in droplets within the shower system, as you'd also expect with badly managed showers with Legionella. So the outcome we get is that almost all the Crohn's patients we know we've tested are affected with paratuberculosis, widely distributed in the environment. It clusters, maybe influenced by aerosols. We know it cycles in the environment, and we know human map is also, some mappers come from humans directly, is also recycled in those catchments. And we get animal-associated transfer from catchment to the river. And it doesn't really rely on extreme weather events. This is just the normal rainfall in the UK, which is fairly consistent. We know that map reaches the consumer by tap and milk. It has a high survival and enhanced pathogenicity. The infection is prevalent in farm animals. Humans are widely exposed. Most people with Crohn's disease are infected with paratuberculosis. And we know it's a multi-host pathogen, which causes virtually the same disease in animals. Why are we also interested in paratuberculosis is we don't think it's actually associated with one disease. So these are a list of other diseases we know it may be associated with. And the other one I work on is type 1 diabetes, because one of the proteins that sticks through the cell wall of paratuberculosis is identical to one of the proteins which is exposed on beta cells, the islets of Langerhans, and and autoimmune disease or an autoimmune response to para can destroy those beta cells and cause type 1 diabetes. So it's a horror story waiting to happen, this organism, and at the moment it's not associated with these, it's not causal of these, but we think it is associated. Mycobacterial ulcerans, just briefly, is quite different. It's slow growing, it's microaerophilic, just the same. It infects the skin and it produces a couple of pathogenicity factors which necrotize the skin, and it's immunosuppressive, and it also so gets rid of pain as well. But the Borrelia ulcer, if you look at tuberculosis and leprosy, is the third major worldwide disease caused by mycobacteria. Paratuberculosis and Crohn's isn't, because it's not accepted. And you can grow it optimally and routinely in the lab, so it's a little bit easier to work with as well. And the ulcer is often painless swelling, and it makes early detection difficult. Ulcerin produces a unique toxin, which causes tissue damage, but also inhibits the immune response, and also allows it to occur with little pain or fever, certainly in the early stages. So it is quite different as well. And with Borrelia ulcer, there's quite a lot of tracking of the disease, so it's kind of well reported. It's across 33 countries across Africa, the Americas and Asia. It's also in Australia and China as well. And you get about 5,000 to 6,000 cases a year, or new cases reported per year across these countries, and there's a list of those as well. And but the clinical and epidemiological aspects, it varies quite a lot. So there's a lot of work to do which kind of mirrors the stuff we've done with paratuberculosis with this organism as well. And there seems to be some control of the Borrelia ulcer at the moment, and this is the World Health Organization data, which I lifted just before I came away. And you can see that there's a general trend that it's decreasing, but that's a decrease on fairly high numbers, so it is still significantly affecting people as well. So in summary, we've got two organisms here causing two quite different diseases, often difficult to detect and diagnose. There's variable treatment and reporting for both. The environment may play a significant role in human exposure. Rainfall, non-extreme for para, maybe more extreme for ulcerans, results in increased infection. We need more information about environmental reservoirs and the association with animals. We need more information on the transmission. We know maps, water, aerosols and food. There's some fairly vague routes for ulcerans, but in effect both have a significant effect on human health. There's a significant infection in young people as well. And as I say, this environmental transmission needs just a little bit more research. Right, thank you very much. That's exactly what we're trying to do at the moment. There's really little epidemiological data. So what we're trying to capture at the moment, and we've just started, is to take all the Crohn's patients we can, the ulcerative colitis patients, anemia patients as controls, and give them a questionnaire. And the questionnaire is about diagnosis and age and sex, but also where they live now, where they live at the time of diagnosis, where they live 5 years and 10 years before, because the onset of this disease is quite long. And so where they live now might give us a skewed bit of information. So that's what we're trying to do. Nobody else is trying to do that at the moment. So, and also from that, because we can get an area code where people live, we can then map it onto Google Maps or whatever, or get Luigi to do it because he's better than me, and we'll see if they start to cluster around these. There's anecdotal information of Crohn's clusters in small villages which are associated with one water source. And we have that in America and in the UK as well. So yeah, there's more work being done on that.
Yeah.
Absolutely, this is one of the reasons I'm here. There are people at the Noguchi as well who work on ulcerans, and they're far more expert than I am on that disease. But there's a willingness between the two groups to actually bring together this kind of environmental approach.
So we see more.
I hope so.
I saw a notice that the epidemiological spread of the disease. From 5,000 or 6,000 thereabouts, I'm mentioning so many from countries. I didn't see my country in Nigeria. But in other parts, the luminance form with occupation there.
Yeah.
So I didn't want to know whether it's there so that I would be able to know the remedies of
the data for it, yeah. It's saying so there's no data for Nigeria, basically. Yeah, there's no data for Nigeria. I couldn't find any. So you always look at those maps where there's no data. It doesn't mean they're exempt. It's just there's no reporting. It's just like certain diseases in the Soviet Union never existed for years and years, and now they do. But in Ghana, there's very little information, but there's a couple of papers been produced about patients and treatment in Ghana. So they'll be the same in Nigeria as well. There's no kind of reporting or need to report this disease at the moment, so it gets underreported.
You did mention or listed rheumatoid arthritis as one of the reasons why we need to test for MMP. Can you
explain that? Yeah, that's something that's coming out of groups in Italy. I don't have the data for that, and I don't work on that aspect, but what they look for is the people who manifest themselves with the disease, but also markers for paratuberculosis at the same time, and also immune markers as well. So in Crohn's disease and a few of the others, what paratuberculosis seems to be able to do is to attack the nerve system as well. So it can go for neural proteins. So that's why I think they've started to make that association. It's the same group in Italy that looks at the multiple sclerosis as look at type 1 diabetes as well. And one group is from Sardinia, where they've got a massive infection within their sheep herd. So paratuberculosis is kind of endemic within that country.
Is the infection itself, like how dangerous should be seen? Is it like once you get infected, you can be sure you get either Crohn's disease or multiple sclerosis, or is it more like a small percentage of the infections that really become
sickness again? That's a fantastic question, but exposure and disease are two different things. We're all exposed, so if there are outbreaks of meningitis, there'd be a huge exposure, but very few people go down with it. It's the same with paratuberculosis. Once you're clinically diagnosed as having Crohn's, there's a good chance it's there. It has to be managed. You're not going to get rid of it. So when people are tested and treated with antibiotics, as some are and some aren't, you can actually get yourself into remission. And if you remove the medication, then it flares up again. So people who've had resection, so they had a piece of colon taken out, and then they'll have it sewn up. They'll get scar tissue. They'll get scar tissue forming on the colon. If you then, sometimes that scar tissue has to be removed because it stops the gut functioning. If you then look into that scar tissue, or the person's not got the clinical signs of Crohn's, there's a lot of paratuberculosis still within that scar tissue, which then can spread again. But again, we're not talking about a causal organism here. We're talking about it's associated. It's a big step to go yet to say that it actually causes Crohn's disease. If it does, it's going to change a huge amount in agriculture. It's going to change our water industry. It's going to change our dairy industry right across Europe and beyond.